This is Company Saturdays. Every Saturday, we present you with another company. Today, we're looking at 15 things you didn't know about Barnes & Noble. Welcome to Alux.com, the place where future billionaires come to get inspired. Hello, Aluxers, and thanks for joining us once again. Today we're looking at the story of an old giant that seems to be on its last legs. The origins of Barnes & Noble can be traced back as far as 1886, but the future looks bleak for the last remaining national bookstore franchise in the U.S. As the world moves towards digital purchases, with Amazon dominating the entire market, bookstores are fast becoming relics of a previous era, much like record stores. But perhaps there's still some hope. With such a vast scope of prime real estate at their disposal and growing a consumer desire for co-working spaces with fantastic coffee outlets, there's a chance that Barnes & Noble can revive and reinvent itself in order to remain a major player in the modern age of information sharing. If you're new here, welcome. Be sure to subscribe and follow us on Instagram at Alux. So, with all that said, let's take a look at the 15 things you didn't know about Barnes & Noble. Number 1. Barnes & Noble was officially founded in 1917. The history of this bookstore can be traced back to 1886, but it was not named Barnes & Noble until 1917. In 1886, Arthur Hinds established a bookstore in the Cooper Union Building of New York and employed a Harvard graduate by the name of Gilbert Noble as a clerk. He was made a partner in 1894, and the bookstore was renamed Hinds & Noble. Then, in 1917, Noble bought out Hinds and partnered up with William Barnes. And it was at this point that the store name was changed to what is still today Barnes & Noble. Number 2. Leonard Riccio bought Barnes & Noble for $1.2 million. In 1972, savvy businessman Leonard Riccio saw the talent potential of Barnes & Noble as an international bookseller and bought the company, with their large flagship store on Fifth Avenue, New York, for $1.2 million. Up until that point, the company had been largely mismanaged and sales were underwhelming. With Leonard Riccio as the new CEO, Barnes & Noble quickly transformed itself into a prosperous franchise. Number 3. Barnes & Noble sold books by mail order in the 1970s, 80s, and 90s. One of Barnes & Noble's first major successes under the leadership of Leonard Riccio was to begin publishing its own books and selling them by mail order to customers all over the United States. Before this time, Barnes & Noble could only reach customers that would physically enter the store in New York and buy books. Catalogs were sent all over the country, and books were sold to a completely new market of nationwide customers. Number 4. Barnes & Noble entered the Guinness Book of World Records in 1974. Barnes & Noble became Guinness World Record breakers in 1974 for having the single largest bookstore in the world. Their store at 105 Fifth Avenue, New York, covered over 150,000 square feet with shelves of books that, if ordered in a single line, would stretch out nearly 13 miles. Before 1974, it was believed that the Foyles Bookstore in London was the largest in the world. Number 5. Barnes & Noble have recorded huge losses for 11 years running. Barnes & Noble have been losing money for 11 years running as of 2018. Their bookstores are often busy, but only with customers that buy a coffee and peruse the magazines and literature. Rarely do people actually buy publications from Barnes & Noble bookstores. In May 2018, their stock price fell by 8%. Since 2013, the company has lost over $1 billion in value. Number 6. The launch of Nook was a huge failure. Barnes & Noble tried to keep up with Amazon in the race to sell ebooks by releasing a device to rival the Kindle called the Nook back in 2009. Initial prospects seemed very good, and Microsoft even made a $300 million investment back in 2012 for a 17.6% stake because they valued the company to be worth around $1.7 billion. However, in 2018, Barnes & Noble announced that Nook had actually caused the corporation a loss of $1.3 billion because sales were nowhere near the desired totals to cover the cost of production, as well as running the online stores. Number 7. Barnes & Noble were viewed as an evil corporation in the 1980s and 90s. As Barnes & Noble expanded, buying out independent bookstores and undercutting the retail prices for New York Times bestsellers, many critics labeled the company as an evil corporation that was suffocating the industry of bookselling by aggressive acquisitions. It seems ironic that in 2018, Barnes & Noble now cowers almost entirely defenselessly under the might of Amazon and Walmart. Number 8. Barnes & Noble fired a CEO for sexual harassment. In July 2018, Demos Panaros was fired from his position as CEO by Barnes & Noble for sexual harassment. Until August 2018, no explanation had come to light. However, when he decided to file a lawsuit against Barnes & Noble for defamation and breach of contract, the mudslinging began. Barnes & Noble stated that one of the major reasons they fired Demos Panaros was because of serious sexual misconduct. Mr. Panaros refutes the claims and says that Barnes & Noble is a company in disarray with the unstable chairman who refuses to relinquish control. He believes that he is owed $4 million in severance pay. I guess we'll have to wait and see how it all shakes out in court. Number 9. Barnes & Noble acquired SparkNotes in 2001. Barnes & Noble acquired SparkNotes for $3.6 million back in 2001. SparkNotes is an online educational service to help students understand the literary dimensions of books that they are assigned to read for school or work as a part of a university course. Some teachers believe that the chapter summaries offered by the company mean that students don't actually have to read the books and defeats the object of teaching English literature in the first place. Nonetheless, it has been a popular website among students for some time now and is 3,904th on the Alexa rankings. Number 10. Barnes & Noble's net worth is around $800 million. Although the company has been in rapid decline for over a decade now, the company still is estimated to be worth around $800 million. Most of this worth is in real estate, as their actual net income ran a deficit of nearly $25 million back in 2017. Their total assets amount to around $2 billion, thanks to the fact they own 600 storefronts in prime mall locations across the United States. Number 11. Barnes & Noble plans to operate as a co-working space in order to survive. Barnes & Noble have decided to focus on their physical spaces of operation in order to drive positive revenues in the future. Most Barnes & Noble bookstores are still very busy, but the main problem is that people are using them more as libraries and coffee shops rather than retail bookstores. Barnes & Noble hopes to capitalize on this traffic by improving the service. As well as selling coffee, they hope to incorporate bars and restaurants in order to turn their bookstores into attractive co-working spaces. Number 12. The fastest-selling book in Barnes & Noble history from 2018 was Michelle Obama's memoir. Michelle Obama's memoir, Becoming, sold over 725,000 copies on its first day of sales, making it the best-selling book since Harper Lee's sequel To Kill a Mockingbird, titled Go Set a Watchman, which came out in 2015. Before the release of Mrs. Obama's memoir, the fastest-selling book of the year had been Fear, Trump in the White House, written by Bob Woodward. Number 13. Barnes & Noble are looking to sell their stores. In October 2018, Barnes & Noble announced they had hired Evercore as their financial advisors and Baker Botts LLP as their legal advisors as they begin negotiations with various parties interested in buying the corporation. Leonard Riggio, the majority stakeholder in the company, has agreed to sell his shares to whoever the board decides to sell to. The future of Barnes & Noble seems extremely uncertain at this time, and many have become hugely interested about who the buyers will end up being. Perhaps you're watching this in the future, and you already know. Number 14. Leonard Riggio is a great philanthropist. Having acquired Barnes & Noble back in 1971, Leonard Riggio has done much with his money in order to aid those less fortunate than himself. He's a benefactor to the Dia Beacon Art Museum in New York, as well as the New York University. He also pledged $20 million through the Riggio Foundation in order to help residents of New Orleans rebuild their homes following the devastation of Hurricane Katrina back in 2005. Number 15. Another giant of the corporate world folds under the pressure of rapid change. With it seeming more likely than ever before that Barnes & Noble will soon become a footnote in history, it's a poignant time to consider how our rapidly changing global economy can create and destroy huge businesses in a very short period of time. It's not fair to simply blame the expansion of Amazon for Barnes & Noble's disastrous decline. Poor management and a lack of innovation meant they were sluggish and unable to remain contemporary. A company of such magnitude and wealth had all the tools at their disposal to keep up, but they didn't have the quality of minds to achieve that goal. If any lesson can be learned from this, it's that no company is ever really secure, and innovation is the key to maintaining success. Well, Aluxers, that's a wrap on 15 things you probably didn't know about Barnes & Noble. Now we have a question for you. If you were to be hired as the CEO of Barnes & Noble tomorrow, what strategies would you put in place to save the company? Let us know in the comments. And as always, for sticking with us until the end, here's your bonus. Number 16. Barnes & Noble was the first store to incorporate Muzak. In 1940, Barnes & Noble began playing Muzak at its Manhattan bookstore. Muzak is a type of easy music that apparently makes customers a lot more relaxed and more likely to buy products. The Muzak company became very successful, and it was actually sold to Mood Media in 2011 for a deal worth $345 million. Thank you for spending some time with us, Aluxer. Make sure to subscribe so you never miss a video. If you want more, we handpicked these videos you might enjoy, or head over to alux.com for the best in fine living content on the planet. Be a part of the largest community of luxury enthusiasts in the world and tell your story.